For the past 2 days, we have been trying to dwell on peace. Peace is our quest in life, and peace is God. So this topic can go for any number of days. But in order to ensure that it doesn't become an academic exercise, we have to keep on bringing into our mind certain touching incidents, episodes, because through that we will be able to have a glimpse of the inner peace. Actually, to be blunt, everybody says, or Mahatmas keep on saying, that inner peace can come only when our life becomes God-centered, not self-centered. So it's a journey from me to we, from individual to universal, from micro to macro. It's the blunt truth. So peace, we'll be able to become aware of the inner peace which passeth all understanding only when the me and mine is totally under control. Normally a person expresses himself in 3 tiers of life. Early morning when he gets up, he is a family being. Then when he goes to the field of profession, we can call him as a professional being. And in the evening when with his friends, we call it as a social being. Now in these 3 tiers, there could be so many challenges that will disturb the peace. How do we tackle them? Not by reading, not by hearing, but only by observing and then trying to make it a reality in our life. It may be a gradual process. One incident that comes up in our mind is, as usual, the husband, wife, child, then they are there in the house, family. The husband has to go to office at about 8:30 in the morning. The child has to go to the school by 8:30. And after doing household work, the wife also goes to her own field of profession by 9:30. So as usual, the mother was busy preparing, you know, for both the child and the husband. He had his bath and had his dress. He came there fully dressed, a white shirt, and he came and sat in the dining table. The daughter also moved to the dining table. The wife, you know, whatever she has prepared, she placed it on the dining table. He was about to eat, or he was eating. Suddenly she brought a cup of coffee or tea also. Unknowingly, unwittingly, because of a slip of her steps, the daughter somehow lost the grip on the teacup. The result was the tea got spilled on the white shirt of her father. He has to attend for a important meeting. Now 2 things could have happened. We will try to go through. What had happened, we will first say. Immediately he lost his temper. He was shouting at her and immediately rushed to the bathroom again, changed the dress, came back. He was in a fit. She did not take any food. He was shouting at the girl also and also to the mother. Is this the way to train? This and that, you know. The daughter was crying. Anyhow, she also did not take. Somehow he got into the car. He did not talk anything to her daughter. Exactly at the particular point, she dropped them. When they are fretting and fuming, in this gadbada, you know, he forgot to take the key. By the time he reached there, you know, total confusion. Again, he sent to somebody to get the key. And we can say the whole day, not only he was miserable, he was making everybody miserable. Wife felt very bad, she also was restless. The whole thing, the whole day. Evening when they came back, everyone was having their own gloomy face, isolating themselves. And even the evening, it had not set in. This is one part. Another part is
mute.
As soon as the shirt got spoiled, he immediately coolly said, "Don't worry." He went immediately to the bathroom, changed the dress. As usual, he was telling, the child felt very bad. "Sorry, Daddy, don't worry. Be careful, a little careful, that's all." Everything was normal. The whole day was as peaceful as it was. So it comes from the self-centeredness, you know. Suddenly, suppose we start thinking, nobody will willfully do anything. It could be a slip. Doesn't matter. Heaven is not going to fall down. Even if I am late for 5 minutes, you can inform them. Get yourself dressed. That means we are accommodating everybody. We are giving space to everybody. We don't allow our peace to be in the pockets of somebody else. No happening from outside, no individual from outside can disturb our peace. Just imagine. When we come across such incidents, suppose we remember this and then try to implement the harmony at home can be always kept. Think about it. We have witnessed this. And then in the evening when we touch upon this in a very passive way, everyone realized, yes, a small thing, we made such a big mess out of it. So everything is within us. It again teaches us that everything is within us. It is up to you to lose your inner peace or not, or to retain it. Initially, we may act. We may react. Doesn't matter. But in the shortest possible time, we should be able to pull us up and try to see a wider dimension. Only when I am in the dimension, I become upset. When it is a wider dimension, there is no problem. I will be able to accommodate, reconcile, you know, adjust, adapt. All these words, you know, it becomes relevant. And the second thing at professional level. When in a company, when the sales representative went on his usual tour, he wrote a report to the office saying that a particular stockist was found keeping a competitor's product quite conspicuous in his shop. So this cannot be agreed, this should be immediately pointed out. And so having got the letter, when the letter was marked to the person who has to handle it, he was a loyal, sincere person. So he drafted a letter saying that being an authorized stockist, it is ethically wrong to keep the product of somebody else in your shop, that too in a conspicuous, where you know it attracts the attention of all. It should not have been done. We have the report that you have done it. Like that, you know, so many words. In an aggressive tone it was drafted. Before it was sent to the manager for signature, somehow the person who drafted felt that he must have a word with manager before finalizing it. So he went inside and showed him the draft. The manager was a very balanced person. He coolly went through the entire draft. Then, in a loving way, he asked, "Why do we think that he has deliberately done? See, suppose he has run out of our stock and a customer comes. He has to meet the demand of the customer. It will be difficult for him to write to us and get the product immediately. So naturally, in order to serve the customer, he would have gone for the another product. And one or two extra he would have put, unknowingly he would have kept it there. Why don't we think that, why should we assume that it has been done deliberately?" So the person who drafted, he said, "No sir, under that protection, no, they will keep on violating it. Unless and until we are strict, things can get diluted." Immediately man, "Yes, yes, agreed. Even if taking it as granted that he has done willfully, our job is to bring him back to our fold, you know. Do you think this approach will make him to come back? We need a customer, no? He needs a customer, we need a customer." And you know, the first lesson in a business is the customer is always right. So what do we do now? Thinking all these, you go, do some thinking, and if you still feel that the letter can go as you have drafted, okay, I will sign. So he sent back the person. That person came back and started thinking. Ah, it could be. Why should we immediately jump into the conclusion that it was deliberately done? So he redrafted the letter. He said, the recent report from one of our sales representative mentioned that he happened to see somebody's product also in your showroom. Probably it would not have been willfully done, out of compulsion you might have done. But still, it doesn't look nice to keep it there. Once in a way, we may have to go in for somebody's product to help a customer. But you will agree that it doesn't go along with the understanding we have with you. Kindly ensure such things do not occur in the future. So when this letter was placed before the manager looked at the person and asked him, "You agree that?" "Yes, sir. Your sign." After 10 or 15 days, we remember the person, the customer called on the manager and apologized for it. There was no accusation, no? The manager did not lose his balance. There are norms for anything and everything. If you go strictly on the norms, we can make others also tensed up. We may offend people. So many things can happen. But when the norms are to be implemented, if care is taken to see that it is lovingly handled, then not only that the norms are enforced, but the relationship with others, it becomes harmonious, intact. Otherwise, you know, both will lose the peace. Each one will hold on to theirs. They may come out with some justification. It may be right also. But from the company's point of view, you may not be able to agree. But there will be a lot of inner conflict. But here, the matured act of the manager not only touched and kindled the goodness in the employee, the goodness in the customer, all because the manager had that inner peace. Anything that disturbs the peace, he is not accommodating. Now, when we come at the social level, we remember one incident. Sometime during the 70s, the agricultural plantation was facing an acute crisis because of poor return for their produce. At the same time, the trade union made a big charter of demand where they wanted a hike in the wages of laborers. Ultimately, when at the lower level no decision was emerging, finally the chief labor commissioner called for a conference where representatives of the planters as well as the union were present. In the course of the deliberations, when the trade union people were vociferously asking for a rise, you know, and the planters, you know, they were vehemently protesting it, somehow one trade union said, then we will not allow the estate to work. So one young, aggressive planter got offended. He stood up. He said, then let us see that. It was an open challenge. The whole scene became, you know, tense. Suddenly, a big planter, having more than 1,000 acres, must be about 60, 70 years old, he got up. Suddenly everybody kept quiet. He said, we have all come here not to fight each other, not to assert that I am right, you are wrong. We have come here to find a solution for the wage rise. When every commodity, the price of every commodity he buys, it goes up and up. Naturally, it is natural on the part of the laborer to ask for a wage rise. It is not a crime. We fully understand that. Now the question is whether we can afford. So you kindly verify the produce that comes out of the land are so and so, so and so, so and so. Productivity is known to everybody. The price of it, average price, is known to everybody. So to have a product from 1 acre, how much would be the cost? And whether a hike in wages, whether it is going to have a negative impact on the industry, on the sector, they may have to close down. At the same time, without laborers, the estate cannot function. Everything has to be done manually only. So even if I close, I have to open it tomorrow. So I don't want to close. Let us all try to bring down these two issues and find an amicable settlement. Immediately the atmosphere became very cool. When they went through the statistics, they were convinced that they cannot ask for a higher wage, but at the same time, some token. Then he said, should it improve, we will definitely raise it. Now we will give a token increase. You know, like that it was settled. Now why we remember that? The attitude of that particular person. He did not want that peace, you know, to be disturbed by anything. So what we find is, the inner peace, whether at the family level or the professional level or the social level, all those things can be ensured only when we have a broader perspective. That is why initially, you know, every Mahatma says, every spiritual saint says, that inner peace can be got only by becoming God-centered, not self-centered. God and peace are not independent. So when we start developing it, everybody will say, I don't have any peace of mind. I work a lot. I do a lot for my family. I do a lot for my company, you know. I am very much with the society. I am concerned about everybody. But still, I don't have any peace of mind. What is happening there? I may be sincere when I am talking all these things, but still it is all self-centered. I have decided that this should be done and this is the one which is going to give me peace. I forget that I am a part of the stupendous whole. I am not an individual by myself. I cannot isolate myself from the rest of the world. I am what I am because of the factors other than me. The simple truth. There is an indwelling reality within me called as God or Atman or Spirit, because of which only I function. And when this sense of individuality has been given to me, I exist because of the factors other than me. I need air to breathe, water to drink, earth to exist, space to move about. They need a temperature to keep us alive. We need sun, we need rains, we need metals, minerals, gases, vegetables, trees, what not. Without these, I don't exist. So I start thinking about it. I am a part. Whatever creature comforts I am enjoying, it is a gift of somebody from some part of the country, some part of the world. If you are using this laptop or this app, particular app, Zoom app, it is a gift of God through somebody else. How can I arrogate? Even the very brush I take, the paste I use, the soap, the wash basin, the commode, the eatables, and everything. Even the very language. Language is a gift given to us. If language is not there, how do we communicate? So when we start thinking that we are what we are because of the factors other than us, slowly, you know, the assertion of me and mine will become less and less. So the greatest roadblock toward the inner peace is the me and mine. So at the outer level, we try to practice accommodating, adapting to, without jumping into any conclusion by ourselves. As we said the other day, giving space to others. We have to give first space to ourselves and know that we are a part of this. We don't have an exclusive space. And then, in Vyavahar, we have to give space to others. That is why that Bertrand Russell the other day quoted, you know, integration with the nature, integration with the mind, integration with the society. That alone can ensure. Integrating means what? Not keeping myself away. becoming one with it. By just hearing this, this cannot be done. Only when we go back to our own life, we find God must have given us umpteen number of opportunities where all these things are being tested on us. We would have failed, we would have succeeded. But at that time, we would not have realized that it's a gateway towards my inner journey, inner peace. But now, when we get in touch with the spiritual preceptor, in our case, you know, Parampuja Papa says, the world we live in is a school in which observation and experience offer us immense possibilities for self-improvement. Nay, the world itself is Guru or God. This we learn because we get in touch with a spiritual preceptor. Not merely listening, not merely writing, not merely memorizing, then we try to apply it in our own life. Then we find, through so many incidents, or through many objects, through so many individuals, through so many situations, the great provider who is within us has been trying to give us wise tuitions. Unless and until we link our day-to-day life with all these, you know, it will never become a part of our life. Parampuja Papa used to say, spirituality that cannot be applied in actual life is no spirituality. There is no divide. Spiritual life and worldly life, no, there is no divide. So inner peace can become a reality only when we try to move in this direction. We may fail, we may forget, because we carry a big baggage, carrying all our fixed notions, preferences, priorities, prejudices, preconceived ideas. Everything is self-centered. So those baggage will definitely prevent us. But when God provides us opportunities to witness certain situations, certain individuals, wherein we find the care and concern, quality care and concern of more and more are accommodated, we slowly start learning. And now one more anecdote comes in our mind. During one of our trips south Kerala, the person organized cluster meetings in so many places. It was very near to the main road. About 40-50 people had assembled. We were asked to share some thoughts. Same topic. Suddenly we looked at the road. One bus was coming from one side. Another auto rickshaw was coming from this side. There was a car parked. And as the auto rickshaw man has already given the signal that he would like to pass first, but ignoring that, the bus had come, and the auto rickshaw also had come there. Auto rickshaw has no space to go because of the parked car. He stopped. Just imagine. He has given the signal. 1 minute. The auto rickshaw man took it on reverse. The bus passed away. Auto rickshaw man went away. It is a big reminder for us. Suppose the auto rickshaw man had told, I have given you the signal, now let us see who goes first. Innocent passengers will be in trouble. Lot of words will be unnecessarily exchanged. Negative thoughts will be welling up. Ultimately, you know, everybody will become bored, get fed up, you know, offended. But the mature act of that auto man, that too in such a short time. Anyway, they had come, you know, it's all right, it's a big vehicle, you cannot go back. I can take it back. It's all the whole thing. It is a big reminder. Immediately we shared that one. This itself is a great lesson for all of us. If in our life's dealings, suppose we can try to bring in these dimensions, which God is teaching us. It is not a story, it is not a textual knowledge. It is something you have seen. Not only you have seen the act, but you have also seen the impact. And the greatness of the Ottoman is, he did not wait for anybody's thanks, you know. Nowadays, whenever we go in metros, when somebody takes us, the problem comes, but the person will stop and the other man will immediately greet him. Here the auto rickshaw man, he did not even wait for that. To him it was very clear. Something had happened. Who is to blame is not important. How to set the situation right. Easy to say all these things. But when we see it in practical life, slowly, drop by drop, it might percolate into our thinking system. And slowly it may become a part of our life. Initially we observe the lives of Mahatmas. There every day there will be a learning. Then we may think, oh, it is all, can be done only by Mahatmas. No. When we come down and keep our eyes open, ears open, we find even an inert, insentient matter also teaches us. Eckhart Tolle used to say, you just look at the tree. How peaceful it is. How still it is. So many things are going on. Metabolism. But it doesn't make any fuss. It exists for others. It gives oxygen to us. It gives fruits, it gives leaves, it gives shade, it indirectly helps for the rains to come. So many. But it doesn't tom-tom. So whenever we look at a tree standing before us, how cool, how still, how peaceful. Like that, you know, we have to keep on. That is why Papa said, the world we live in is a school. So in order that we get totally convinced about the need to unearth the inner peace within us, we have to do this type of schooling. Not by going to a school or a college or writing a PhD, but it is by closely associating ourselves with the creation in and around us. With no biased views. We go there with our plain mind. Watch them.